In this video, we're going to be discussing how we can use the laws of logarithms to combine logarithms together into a single logarithm. So the idea on this is we have our three laws of logarithms. These are the big ones that only apply to logarithmic functions. So we have the multiplication rule, or property here, where in another video I discussed going from the left-hand side over to the right-hand side. But in this case, what we have is if we have two logarithms that are added together, what we're going to be able to do is combine those into a single logarithm where these are connected with multiplication. Or if we have two logarithms that are subtracted, we're going to combine those using a fraction or a quotient, right, a division over on the left-hand side. And the very last one is if we have a multiple sitting out in front of a logarithm, what we're allowed to do is move that up into the exponent and raise whatever's on the inside of the logarithm up to that power. So basically, we want to make sure that we're condensing these together. We're going to be moving from the right-hand side to the left-hand side on each and every one of these. If you want to see how to split them apart, what you can do is you can watch that other video that has to do with moving from the left to the right-hand side. So let's talk through how to condense these together. And there are different ways we could put the exact same directions to you. One would be to combine our logs together into a single logarithm. Another would be to condense them together. So taking a look at this first one, we have log base b of 36 minus log base b of 4. With a subtraction in between there, we're going to use our second rule that says we can make this into a fraction inside of a single logarithm. Now, it is important that our logarithms have the exact same base for us to be able to use these rules. But we have those in this case. So we can say log base b of 36 over 4 as a single logarithm condensed together. Now, we could simplify this a little bit further where we put log base b, and then 36 divided by 4 is going to make a 9 on the inside. And that's as simplified down as this one is going to get. Moving over to the right-hand side, we have log base 3 of 2 plus log base 3 of x. So in this case, we have addition going on. It'll be our top rule that has to do with a product. So we can say log base 3 of 2 multiplied by x. Now in this situation, we can't simplify anymore because we have a variable and a constant, so we'll leave it just like that. Moving down below, we'll be able to simplify these perhaps a little bit more than just one step. So on the next two, I notice that we have a multiple sitting out in front of the logarithm. What we want to do first is take the multiple out in front and move it up to the exponent. So on the first one, we have 1/2 times the natural log of 81. That 1/2 is going to get moved up and going to get attached to the 81 as an exponent. So we have natural log of 81 raised to the 1/2 power. Now 1/2 as an exponent is equivalent to a square root. So really we have natural log of the square root of 81, which we'll simplify a little bit. We probably should get a little bit cleaner answer. The best answer we can get is the natural log of 9. Now, because we did not apply a square root to both sides of an equation, we should not put a plus and minus out in front. Plus, it wouldn't make much sense to have a negative on the inside of a logarithm anyway. That's not allowed. Next up, we have 2 multiplied by the log base 9 of 7. Let's move the 2 up to the exponent as our first step. So we can say that's log base 9 of 7 squared, but a little bit better answer would be simplifying down 7 squared would be log base 9 of 49. Last one of these before we move on to a little bit more difficult ones, we have a negative sitting out in front of the log base 5 of 1/7. So with this, that is a negative 1 being multiplied out in front. We want to move that up to the exponent to begin with. So we can write log base 5 of 1/7 all raised to the negative first power. Now, what we are allowed to do is use one of our exponent rules that says you can bring that exponent to the inside of the fraction and multiply exponents together. So 1 raised to the first power is going to get multiplied by the negative 1 for its exponent, and 7 raised to the first power, we're going to multiply its exponent also by a negative 1. So we have 1 to the negative first over 7 to the negative first, all on the inside of this log base 5. Now, what I would probably do is I would rewrite this without my negative exponent. So to do so, we can make them positive exponents by switching positions. So if I'm going from numerator to denominator, I can write 1 to the positive first power down here, and the 7 to the negative first is in the denominator. We can move it up to the numerator and make it 7 to the positive first power, thus eliminating all of our negative exponents. A little bit better answer, instead of saying 7 divided by 1, is just going to be put 7 on the inside here. And that's the best answer we can get to on this one. Next up, moving down below, we could have different directions saying write these as a single logarithm with a leading coefficient of 1. That's given us the same directions, it's just putting it a different way. That we want to move, if we take a look back up here at our laws of logarithms, move from the right-hand side to the left-hand side into a single logarithm, or combine these together or condense them together. All right, so writing these as a single logarithm, what I'm going to do is they have to have all the same bases. Natural logs, of course, are logarithms with base e, so we are allowed to use these laws or properties of logarithms for these. What I'm going to do on this is initially just take it one step at a time. I'm going to ignore the last logarithm, the natural log of y, and just work on the first two. Noticing that we have a subtraction, I'm going to go ahead and make that into a quotient or a fraction. So we have x goes to the numerator, z goes to the denominator, and for the time being, I'll bring along the natural log of y. Next up, we have two logs that are being subtracted, so that's again going to be a fraction. I could write natural log of x over 7, x over z, that's a z, divided by y. But that's not really the best answer we can get to because we have a fraction inside of a fraction. One way to clean this up a little bit is, that is like a y over 1 is our bottom fraction. We can multiply numerator and denominator both by 1 over y with the goal of getting a 1 down here as we multiply these together. We would get y over y, which makes a 1. Thinking about the top fractions, we have x over z multiplied by 1 over y makes x over z y. Sometimes we call this keep change flip, but that's what's going on in the background. If you want to do keep change flip, that's okay too. Another thing you should probably double check on these, and it's really handy to double check, is notice from the original problem, we had a positive natural log of x. That was positive out in front of that natural log, and notice that the x ended up in the numerator of our combined together natural log. It was a negative out in front up here of this natural log of z, and notice that the z ended up in the denominator of the combined version. It was also negative for the natural log of y. The y ended up in the denominator. So that's something you can double check. We want to show our work the whole way through, but that's how you can double check when you get done at the end. Moving over to the right-hand side, you'll notice that we have 5 multiplied by the common log of x plus 2 multiplied by the common log of the quantity x plus 3. The first thing we need to do is take care of those multiples out in front. That these multiples out in front need to move up to the exponent and attach to everything that's on the inside of those logarithms. So we have log of x raised to the 5th power, because x was the only thing on the inside of that one, plus log, this time it's going to be x plus 3, all raised to the 2nd power. Because it was x plus 3 on the inside, we have to move that 2 all the way up into the exponent and attach it to the whole thing. It's not okay to say it's x squared plus 3 squared or something like that. Those have different meanings. Now to finish this up, we have 2 separate logs that are being added together. We need to combine those together. So we're going to say log of, because these were added, we're going to use multiplication to combine them together. So I'm going to go ahead and say x to the 5th multiplied by x plus 3 quantity squared. And all of that is inside of the one large common log. So that's why I use the big set of brackets to go around the whole thing. All right, last two. On this next one, 3 log base 4 of a minus log base 4 of b plus 5 log base 4 of c, we want to combine these all together. So my first step is any of these multiples out in front go up to the exponents. So looking at that 3, looking at the 5, so we can say log base 4 of a cubed. Didn't have one here, so I'll just copy it back down. Plus log base 4 of c to the fifth power. So those move up to the exponents first. Next, I'm just going to work my way left to right, combining these together. So first of all, we have log base 4. And with this subtraction, it's going to become a fraction. So the a cubed goes in the numerator. The b goes in the denominator. I'm going to go ahead and bring down log base 4 of c to the fifth. Next up, we have two logs that are added together. We're going to use multiplication to combine these together. So we can say log base 4 of whatever's inside of the first one, that was a cubed over b, multiplied by what was in the second one. So that was c to the fifth power. Now we can visualize that c to the fifth as being a fraction as well if we'd like to put it over 1. And maybe the best answer we can think about here is not going to be a 4 down there, or is going to be a 4 down there, not going to be a 5. So we have log base 4, that stays consistent throughout, and then to combine these fractions together, you would multiply numerators and multiply denominators. So b times 1 is going to make a b down there. Another good thing to double check when you get done with this is the a log from the beginning was positive. Notice that it ended up in the numerator. The b was negative out in front. Notice it ended up in the denominator. And the c was positive out in front. Notice that part went up in the numerator to finish this up. Did not mean to get rid of the bottom of our b. And lastly, we could be given problems where we're asked to evaluate when they're all constants. So in this case, looking at this very last problem, we have 2 multiplied by log base 6 of 3 plus 2 multiplied by log base 6 of 2. So kind of the same idea using these same techniques. What we're going to do is try to combine this together to begin with. So multiples out in front, going to go up to the exponents. So we can write this as log base 6 of 3 squared plus log base 6 of 2 squared. Well, those will simplify down a little bit if we'd like to. We can say 3 squared is the same thing as 9. And 2 squared is the same thing as 4. Now we can't go and cancel anything out at this point, but we could combine these into a single logarithm. Because they're both log base 6s, since they're added together, what we're allowed to do is just multiply on the inside of a single logarithm. 9 times 4 can go together. Now to finish this up, you'll notice that 9 times 4, we can get a better answer than that. We could write that as 36. But since the end goal here is to evaluate this as much as possible, you may recall that if you get the same base for your logarithmic part, as you do with what's inside here, if we can rewrite that as 6 to a power, we're gonna get really nice canceling out. And that's one of the toughest things to kind of recognize, and it takes some practice, but it's not that bad. Because what we're allowed to do is write log base 6, I'm not gonna change that, but I can rewrite 36 as 6 squared. Because of this, we have the same base for the logarithmic part as we do here on the inside. We have an exponential part. Because logarithmic functions and exponential functions are inverses of one another, these are going to get to cancel out, and we're going to be left with just the exponent. So we're going to be left with 2 as our final evaluation of this very difficult looking initial problem. It simplifies all the way down just to being 2. So I hope this all helped out. We have some more videos still coming with solving down equations. There are going to be quite a few of those videos because there are quite a few different types of equations that we may need to be solving down for both exponential equations and logarithmic equations. Hit the subscribe button and you'll receive notifications when those are available to watch. Anyway, till next time, we'll see you.